there was a crazy column in the New York Times from opinion writer Thomas Friedman, and he is floating this idea of a Joe Biden national unity cabinet. He says that saying that he was going to have a female running mate was a great first step for Joe Biden trying to bring the country together, but that he also has to bring in all of these different wings of the Democratic Party into his cabinet so that people will feel comfortable voting for him from all across the political spectrum. And I was reading through this piece, and pretty much all of the suggestions are batshit crazy, but the most insane one is that he wants Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, the freshman Democratic rep from New York, to be the UN ambassador. Now, remember, this is a position that was previously held by Nikki Haley, famously in the Trump administration. And this is the person who actually goes and advocates on behalf of America to the United Nations. So on a very basic level, they have to have some understanding of foreign policy, and it's usually good for them to have some type of executive experience before going into this position, or at the very least, national security experience. And as I'm sure you all know, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez has none, perhaps even worse than none, because the things that she does know are completely wrong. A perfect example of her experience for this position was, of course, this interview she had on Firing Line towards the beginning of her political career, where she said she was not the expert on geopolitics. Here's a refresher.
What people are starting to see, at least in the occupation of Palestine, is just an increasing crisis of humanitarian condition.
Do you think you can expand on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'd also just, I am not the expert on geopolitics on this issue. You know, for me, I'm a firm believer in finding a two-state solution in this issue.
The New York Times could not be satisfied with just one crazy op-ed this week. They decided that they needed two, so they commissioned an op-ed from the Chinese ambassador to the United States, and this thing is just chock full of Communist Party propaganda, with no indication from the New York Times that any of this could be untrue, or no editor's note explaining that this guy is just repeating talking points from his government that have been shown to be inaccurate. Here are some of the things that he said in this op-ed. First, he claimed that China has been providing updates about the disease in a responsible manner, which of course is insane because they've been claiming for the past couple of weeks that there have been no new deaths from the coronavirus, despite the fact that we've seen thousands of urns being delivered to hospitals. They've also claimed no new cases, that any new cases are actually coming from people who are traveling into China from other areas of the country, which is just an insane thing to say considering this first spread because Chinese nationals were traveling outside of China after the initial outbreak. This guy also claims that China has been sending test kits, protective masks, and medical equipment to overrun hospitals in the United States and many other countries. This is very misleading because, as we know, China has actually been making other countries buy personal protective equipment, which is especially scummy because they received a bunch of donated materials after the initial outbreak from the United States, from Italy, from a number of other countries who saw what was happening and decided to be humanitarian and help out China. And China repaid the favor by making them purchase back all of that equipment. So they're not doing this out of the goodness of their hearts. And by the way, this is even more so not a humanitarian effort by China, because the clear goal that they have in mind here is not to actually help the rest of the world battle this virus, because if they cared about that, they would be honest about their numbers. Instead, they're just trying to make up for the fact that they screwed this up so badly. They're trying to make themselves look good. This is furtherance of their propaganda efforts to say, look, see, China couldn't possibly be responsible for the spread of this virus because we are doing so much to help. And I want to point out, too, what a senior administration official in the Trump administration told me, which is that, of course, China should be helping. They have a special responsibility to help because of their culpability in allowing this virus to spread unchecked for so long. So this is not something that China should be getting a pat on the back for. And this guy also said that people should clearly say no to the folly of fanning racism and xenophobia and to scapegoating other countries or races. This is obviously in response to the fact that people are calling this the China virus or the Wuhan virus, which is not racist. It's not about anything to do with nationality or the fact that these people are Chinese, it has to do with the origins of the virus, which were in the Wuhan province, and apparently either from a wet market or leaked from a lab. We still don't actually know because China won't tell us anything about where the virus came from. And so it's totally reasonable, as I've said on this podcast before, for people to refer to this virus as the Chinese virus because they should be pressured into revealing information about how this got out, how it spread across the world. And until they do that, just keep putting the pressure on. They deserve it. It's crazy that the New York Times decided that this Chinese ambassador's propaganda was worth putting in their newspaper, especially without, again, an editor's note explaining what was going on. I would loathe to see people actually buying this propaganda. Unfortunately, much of the media already has. Part of that, in fact, might be due to the fact that various media outlets in the U.S. actually have business deals with China. And Arthur Bloom, who is a former Daily Caller editor, he now writes for the American Conservative, laid this out really well in an article a couple of weeks ago. And he explained that there's actually a business deal between NBC Universal to build a major theme park in China worth billions of dollars. And so he suggests that these media outlets could be concerned that if they do criticize China and blame them for the spread of the virus, then they could potentially back out some of these major business deals that the media companies have there. If you ever read the Washington Post or the New York Times, you know that they've also, over the years, had inserts from Chinese state media inside of their newspapers. So feeding this CCP propaganda directly to the American people. The whole thing is a complete farce. They love to talk about freedom of the press, but then they constantly give fodder to a country that is authoritarian and constantly stomps on its press, expelling journalists who write or say things that are critical about the Communist Party or China in general. They've locked up journalists. Journalists have disappeared after criticizing the party. The whole thing is an absolute disaster over in China. And for American media companies to be flacking for them or allowing their propaganda to go in their pages unchecked is perhaps one of the worst things that I have seen in media. It's one thing to be biased against Trump. It's one thing to be elitist and not understand rural America, for example, but to sit here and share Communist Party propaganda just reaches a whole different level of awful.